and get started. Glad to see so many faces here today. I'd like to welcome you all to today's Careers in Math panel program. Today's event is sponsored by Career Services, the Math Club, the Department of Mathematics, and the Alumni Affairs Office. This program was developed as an opportunity for you to hear from Bridgewater alumni as they discuss their careers in math. Our discussion today will center on different career paths that are rooted in math and the importance of gaining what we call value-added experiences, which will aid for you as you plan your job search after graduation. So for those of you attending a panel discussion for the first time, I thought I'd just give a general overview of the program. During the panel, I'm going to ask a series of questions to our panelists, and at the end of the discussion, I'll leave time for you to ask them questions of your own. We have provided you with a handout of recommendations and just some tips on how to approach a panel discussion. And afterwards, once the panel is actually complete, we would be offering some food and drinks outside in the atrium. So feel free to join us for that chance to network with our alumni panelists. They're very excited to meet all of you. So now I'd like to introduce our panelists. So first, we have Christopher Rock. Chris is an application specialist at MEDITECH. In the middle, we have Carol Humphrey. Carol is a state actuary at Liberty Mutual. And to my far right, we have Kevin Sawyer, who is the math coordinator within the Silver Lake Regional Schools. So each of these panelists have their professional bios, which are printed in the brochure that you probably picked up outside. So be sure to read through those to get a much clearer sense of their overall career path and why they're here today. So let's begin the panel with a series of questions. So why don't we just start, I guess, Chris, if you feel like starting. Could you describe your career path and how you got to where you are today?
Well, my career path really just involves mathematics, as you can probably tell. I started Bridgewater with a double major in mathematics and physics. Over that time, I kind of just picked up some computer science classes and started getting into the world of computers. I work right now at a software company that allows me to utilize my skills using computer technology and everything like that. Mathematics as a whole helps me with logic and proofs and things like that about troubleshooting and debugging issues that I have in the software, and that's what allows me to do my job. But I really didn't think that I was going into computer science as much, but I guess that there's a lot of relation between computer science and the ideals behind mathematics and the mathematical sciences and everything. So I kind of got caught up in that, and I'm fairly fresh out of college, so I can take the next step after that. But that's where that's gotten me so far today.
Hi, I'm Carol Humphrey. I graduated from Bridgewater in 1993 with a math major. I basically was thinking I was going to be a math teacher, a high school teacher, and actually is not that different than today. We were in the middle of a recession, and I could see that it was hard to get a teaching job, and so I started to research what other things I could do with a math degree, and started to educate myself about what is this thing called an actuary, which I think is amazing. I just heard that you have an actuarial science minor here, which boggles my mind. So I basically started researching it and took, I think I took maybe one or two exams before I graduated, just using my notes from the classes that all of you take. I then went on to Boston College and got my master's in math. It was a two-year program, and in between the 2 years, I interned at Liberty Mutual in one of their actuarial departments, and had a job offer by Thanksgiving, wasn't graduating until the following May or June, and I've been there now for 19 years, which is insane. but it's been a great company. It's huge, and so, you know, we're not only our home office is in Boston, but all over the world we have, so there's lots of different opportunities at Liberty Mutual. So I've managed to always feel challenged, and some of my roles have been a more traditional actuarial role, whereas other roles I've been their assistant controller in their personal lines finance department. I've been an AVP of their regional operations, but all of the jobs I've had with Liberty Mutual, being an actuary has opened that door, and they've all required strong analytical skills.
Kevin.
Hi, I'm Kevin Sawyer, and I serve as the curriculum coordinator for mathematics and computer ed at the Silver Lake Regional School District. I graduated from Bridgewater State, then college, in 1989, and grew up in West Bridgewater, so I'm a local boy. Came here with an undeclared major, and my very first semester I decided, because math was not my thing, I was going to take my one math class and kind of get that out of the way, and then go on and pursue a teaching degree in English. So I had Dr. Jean Prendergast, who some of the faculty here will remember well, and she was my first professor. I placed into calculus, but decided to take the easy route and took a pre-calculus course because it was going to be the one and only math class I was going to take. And at the end of that course, after getting an A, Dr. Prendergast came up to me during the final and said, you did really well in my course. I'm wondering if maybe you'd like to be a tutor in the math lab here on campus. And by the way, I'm teaching calculus one next semester. I'd like you to take my course. Oh, no thanks, Dr. Prendergast. I've had my math and I'm all set now. But I decided for whatever reason to do it, and I took her Calculus 1 class, and then the end of that, it was, by the way, I'm teaching Calculus 2 next semester. I'd like you to take my class, so I took Calculus 2. Well, I had Dr. Prendergast four times over the course of my career here at Bridgewater. I worked for her in the math lab. She ended up being my student teaching supervisor, and basically a second mother to me. So I think in that sense, if you can connect with a faculty member, sometimes that's what it took for me. In fact, I remember my junior year here, her saying, you do realize that you can't leave this fine institution until you pick something, right? And so she basically told me I was going to be a high school math teacher, and that was what sort of steered me in the direction. So I credit my career basically to her.
That's great.
And as you can tell, there's definitely a large support from the math department. Look at how many faculty members are here. So I'm assuming they want to engage with you and they want to help you, just as your professor did, so that's nice. Moving on, if you could describe a typical day in your job, and specifically how you use math as a foundation for your work. Kevin, would you like to start?
Sure.
You teach math, so.
Sure I do. My job allows me to teach one class at the high school, and then I'm the director of the program for our middle and high school. I've also served in a K-12 capacity in my school. I've been there for 23 years, so I've sort of played a variety of roles. So on a day-to-day basis, I suppose a lot of you probably, even when you were in high school or now in college, probably wonder if you're ever going to really use some of the stuff in the real world. Well, I really do factor polynomials and use the laws of exponents every day in my work. It's amazing. I don't know how many people can say that. But I teach my one class, so in that sense, I get to do the lesson planning for that one course, and because I do the schedule, I choose whatever course I want or wherever the greatest need is. But on a broader sense, I'm working with curriculum. I'm in charge of all things curriculum, instruction, and assessment for the 7 through 12 school system. So a lot of times my work involves me taking a certain broad area of content, maybe, for example, ratio and proportionality, and thinking, how am I going to now provide professional development to the teachers in my school system to know how to teach that concept beyond just the construct of the textbook? And more importantly, how am I going to get it to the teachers to understand the scope of what a sixth grade student should be able to do with that topic, and how will it look different when these kids get to seventh grade and eighth grade? What's the continuum of a particular spectrum of mathematics look like in a middle to high school continuum? So a large part of my job is really the joy of lesson planning and in deciding on how and what will be taught at a particular grade, although that isn't so much my decision as a state decision, but making sure that that's really done. So overseeing all things curriculum, instruction, and assessment within the school system.
Thank you.
Okay. So I'm an actuary, and a lot of people, hopefully more people in this room know what that is. A lot of people don't know what it is, but to sum it all up, we assess and manage risk. That's, I think, sums it all up of what I do. So I work for Liberty Mutual, which is an insurance company. I work in their personal lines state management department. So personal lines would be insurance that you and I would buy, auto insurance, homeowners insurance, but there are other departments, commercial lines insurance, etc., that Liberty Mutual has. In their state management department, they have a few actuaries that are more senior level that deal with their largest states. And so because those states, there's a lot of premium at risk. And also oftentimes there's just complexities, whether it be regulatory or what have you. So I work primarily with New York and Pennsylvania. New York alone has almost $1 billion in premium in their auto and home. So I, with New York, what I do is I advise senior management what they should be charging for their premiums, the rates that our New York policyholders hold, pay, not only at a statewide basis, basically advising senior management what they should be charging in order to make a fair rate of return, but also at the coverage level, at the customer segment level, so that would be things like discounts, et cetera. You know, obviously not everybody gets the same rate. So that's something that I do. Whenever we make a rate change or want to make a change to our rating program, we have to file that with the states, so their departments of insurance. So I'm involved with providing the actuarial justification. Oftentimes with states, especially states like New York, it's very political. So I have to go to the Department of Insurance and defend Liberty Mutual, you know, convince them of what we want to do is the right thing and is actuarially justified, as well as negotiate. You definitely have to be a little savvy with those New Yorkers. It's not always about the numbers, as I've been actually told. You know, I've actually had one time them say, it's actually nothing to do with the, you know, it's bigger than that. It's public perception and what is the press going to say, et cetera. So you have to kind of, I always think of like what Oprah would say, what is the real question? Like you have to kind of think behind, like where are they coming from and strategize even before we make the filing, what possible things could they, you know, how could it all play out? I also am very involved with just advising senior management of what we're seeing in our premium trends. So if we take, you know, a 5% rate increase, we're not necessarily going to receive, not all of that 5% is going to stick. Sometimes it's more, sometimes it's less because of customer behavior. So analyzing those trends, because it helps us in terms of trying to understand, you know, for planning purposes, for forecasting purposes. So that's more, not just the two states, but at a countrywide level. And I work closely during the year with forecasting as well as you know, for their planning, working with our finance department and our state management and our product departments.
Great. And Chris?
Well, there's not much glory to what I do sitting behind a computer desk, but it does have its perks. As soon as I get to work every day, you know, log into the staff system that we have, I sign into my emails, I read my emails and everything like that. It's, like I said, it's not very glorious. From 9 to 5:30, I'm just in front of my computer with my headphones on, just trying to fix problems and trying to debug code and everything like that. It is fairly interesting. Some of the problems I have, I'd have to get into the software to actually explain it to you, but pretty much every day, all I'm using is things like logic, statistics, problem solving. Every once in a while I'll have to dive into proofs to try and solve a problem or prove to somebody that something needs to be fixed a certain way. But other than that, it's just, like I said, it's just a 9 to 5:30, not very exciting. But yeah, I get to sit by myself and listen to my, let's see, what are the Beatles and some new music that came out. Everything like that.
So
it's nice.
Keeps you busy.
Yeah.
And Chris,
busy.
Do you mind giving just a quick overview of MEDITECH sort of as a company? Just we like to kind of discuss that. Not everyone knows what MEDITECH does.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
That'd be great.
MEDITECH is actually the leading, I guess you could say, shareholder of the United States and Canadian healthcare information systems. Mm-hmm. What we do is we run software for hospitals and health sites all over, again, the United States and Canada. And what the company is split up into applications. You may have heard of applications in Microsoft or other software that you have. MEDITECH has applications like for certain departments, like the emergency department, the physician department, laboratory, lab results, radiology, things like that. So the company is actually split up into the applications or departments, like I said, and specifically the emergency department is where I look to work and debug code and everything like that, make sure that all the site's services and their networks are all lined up, every site has their ducks in a row so that the software can operate to ideal situations.
Great. And MEDITECH is a company that Bridgewater works pretty closely with, specifically in career services. So if any of you are interested in some of the work that Chris is doing, I'd recommend that you speak to us because we have a special program that we do each winter. It's called our Job Shadow Program. And students can actually sign up to go on a day-long job shadow at MEDITECH. So you would actually be able to observe some professionals and different type of opportunities that are available at a company like MEDITECH. We also have a recruiter who regularly works with our office, and she comes in and does resume critiques. Every now and then she'll do a workshop. So we do have a great relationship with MEDITECH, and again, if you're interested, feel free to check that out further so you can learn more about the organization. Thanks, Chris.
Sure.
Moving on, could you talk about what is the best preparation for a career in your specific industry? And if you could specifically discuss, you know, education requirements, including graduate school, licensure, et cetera, those type of things. And Carol, why don't you start? Because I think there's a big preparation process for actuaries.
I would say most actuaries graduate with a major in math, but not all. We definitely have people who majored in economics, but it has to be, bottom line, you have to have a very strong analytical background. But I would say the majority of people who pursue this field were math majors. I happen to have a master's. I don't think that you necessarily have to have a graduate degree, but the exams are really where it comes in to play as far as the additional education that you need as an actuary. I would say that I think it's very helpful to pass at least the first two exams before you graduate, if possible. The field is very competitive, and you know, the employers are going to be looking to, in order to succeed in this field, you need to pass the actuarial exams. That's how you get your designation. So if you can already demonstrate that you have one or two exams, that helps you tremendously. And as I said, the first two exams, I didn't go to any conferences or seminars. I just really looked at my notes from the classes I had taken at Bridgewater. I strongly, strongly encourage people to have an internship. I'm a huge internship person, and I think that it benefits not only you to really find out, is this what I want to do, but it also, I mean, I can speak, you know, on behalf of Liberty Mutual, that when we interview our interns, our expectation is as long as things are going well, we're going to offer them a job. So we're interviewing them like a full day interview as if they're a prospective employee, permanent employee, and because, which makes sense. We're investing in them. We're going to be training them, you know, and so it's a great way to, even if you go through that and you say, you know what, this isn't for me, it's great on your resume. I mean, it looks a lot better on your resume to say, I interned, whether it's an actuarial department or not, in the area of the field that you're thinking of, than something that really has nothing to do with what you want to do. It's just, I just think it opens up so many doors. So I'm a huge intern.
Yeah,
proponent.
Yeah, and in terms of internships, Career Services works very closely with all the academic departments. I'm not sure if you knew, but when you're a junior or senior, you can actually apply to get academic credit for an internship. So instead of taking one of your elective courses, you could replace that with an internship, kind of get some work experience related to your field, and still get credits for that. And Professor Usa would be the faculty member within the math department that you'd speak to regarding internships for credit. But Career Services can help you specifically with the search process, getting your resume going, you know, looking online. And on one of the sheets that I provided, there's actually some sample lists of internship sites that Career Services works with. So we actually have a database called CareerLink, and that's on your handout there. I think it says CareerLink for internships. You can make an account on CareerLink, and you have access to those internships as well as full-time jobs now and as an alum. So there's some great resources out there, just as Carol said, to help you get some experience while you're still in school and while you're still studying.
Could
so
I
that's
add
a good
just
point.
One more thing?
Absolutely.
I would just say, as far as the exams are concerned, I think that if you're the type of person who is considering like going to graduate school, furthering your education, you have to be that type of person because you're going to be studying outside of work on the weekends. Mm-hmm. But I think it's a great, if you're that type of person, it's a great career, because most companies will give you time at work, paid time at work to study. You still have to study, you know, outside of work as well. But I think it's a wonderful way to take control of your career. So like at Liberty Mutual, every exam you pass, you get a raise. Every so many exams you pass, you're up for promotion. So I loved that about the career, that you really have control over your destiny.
Definitely. And Carol, just to ask, are there would your employer pay for those exams for you?
Oh yeah.
They'll pay for the exams, yeah. And then that would potentially allow you to get promotion as you're moving forward.
They'll pay for the exams, mm-hmm. any materials. If you want to go to a seminar, they'll pay for that. And it's all, you know, like if you go to the seminar, that's work time. You're not taking that out of your own time. And you know, I used to know this off the top of my head, but like, you know, you might get like 120 hours for an exam in a sitting, you know, to pass, you know, or to take the exam. And then usually every company's different, mm-hmm. but it's not like if you fail it, then you're out. I mean, believe me, I've been there, done that. I've passed on the first time. I've passed on the third time in tears. Like, so I can sympathize with anyone. So I think like they want you to succeed.
Right, they support you through the process. That's great. Excellent. Chris, do you
want to
go next?
Unfortunately, I guess I can't really say that I have a career right now in the position that I am. I'm still actually at an entry-level position, so to be hired to be working there is pretty much just good enough for me, essentially. I do want to progress throughout and have a career, and MEDITECH allows you to rise through the ranks, so to speak. They hire you as an entry level, and then you work your way doing the things that you do, earn experience, and then you get a promotion or you'll get transferred to a different group or whatever. So I guess I can't really say that it's a career. However, I have a degree in mathematics with minors in both physics and actuarial science. Oddly enough, during the interview, they told me that I was being hired for my customer service experience that I received over at Career Services for 2 years. So it was funny how it worked. I guess I had all my analytical skills in line for the mathematics degree with the actuarial science major, but they hired me for what I did during school, so that was pretty interesting. I guess that's a pretty good indicator that they look at other things on the resumes besides the degrees or besides what classes you've taken. So that was really a good kind of a wake-up call for me, that they were just kind of looking for my customer service experience as opposed to the actual degree itself. So.
Yeah, and that would be a great example of sort of that value-added experience that we mentioned. You know, academically, you might do really well in your classwork and, you know, receive the degree, but having those external pieces such as an internship or a part-time job or something that kind of gives you added bonus or a kicker, that's what employers want to see, because it shows those skill sets that are really important for a well-rounded job. So that's great. And how about Kevin?
And in my school, the hiring process goes kind of like this, and it's probably typical of most schools. The principal in the state of Massachusetts has the hiring and firing capacity. He's the one who does it, he or she. But it kind of goes on the recommendation of people like me in middle management. So I screen all the applicants who are looking for a math position, and I put them into three piles, the good, the bad, the ugly. And then if I decide that there's somebody worthy of an interview, I do a preliminary interview with the person, and then if I like the person, I bring them forward to the principal, we co-interview, and then make a recommendation to hire. So what makes a candidate attractive to me, depending on the year and how many people I need, I can be more selective some years than others, but what makes an attractive candidate is somebody who certainly is a math major, as opposed to, I have hired people who are not math majors, but I feel like I'm taking more of a risk, it's more of a gamble whether they'll work out or not. Mm-hmm. And if they have a secondary ed minor, or they've at least done an education program prior to teaching, I find that preferable. I've hired people who, a couple years back, I needed about 7 teachers for the high school that year, so I was not as selective as I would like to have been, or I didn't have as many options, let's say. So I took some people who hadn't student taught, or done their practice teaching. And to me, that's more of a gamble again. I would rather take someone who's had that experience, who's gone through those weeks of practice teaching, and who's already passed the test, and I feel more confident that they'll be ready to step into a classroom with some level of success. The minimum expectation is that you've passed the test, the teacher test. So you take the MTEL and you pass, but let's say you do that with a math major and you haven't gone through an education preparation program. Then you'd be entering the school system on a preliminary license, not an initial license. So again, I prefer somebody who's on an initial license because I know they've had the education coursework behind them. Kind of like Carol was saying about the tests, the other thing that I think is important and good advice to you might be study for those tests. Because, for example, the communication literacy test that's part of the MTEL, the non-subject specific one, you know, I don't want to see somebody that has to take that test three times, that they failed it twice and then taking it a third time, because to me that's a pretty basic test of your ability to communicate. And as an educator, that's a big part of what you do. You communicate to your students either in, you know, orally or in writing. So I would take those tests seriously and try to get them passed the first time. It might mean studying up on the English and knowing, you know, what you need to know there, but that's an important piece. And then the other thing is, what's going to make your resume when it crosses my desk look different than somebody else? What's going to make you a more attractive candidate? Well, I think for one thing, depending on what courses you took here, maybe if you had a minor, for example, if you have the education minor, that's great, but maybe you also have a heavy concentration in something else, like special education. That might make you stand out from somebody else. Back in my day here at Bridgewater, I took the one required special education course, but then I realized once I started teaching, a lot of the classes I'm dealing with have a high percentage of special education students, and you know, I fumbled my way through in those early years and got there, but maybe if I was a little more equipped through the coursework, that would have been better for me. Also, there's a big demand in schools right now for physics teachers, so maybe if you had a double major or a minor in physics, something like that, it makes you more marketable. So what can you do to make yourself look more marketable than somebody else with a math major is the question you want to ask yourself.
Yeah, those are definitely the critical need areas in education, as you said, special ed, sciences, and math. So if you have those experiences, hopefully with a well-rounded teacher preparation program and student teaching, you'll be a good marketable candidate. That's great. Could you discuss what type of experiences students in this room should gain while they're here at Bridgewater to help prepare them for a career in your industry? And this could be, you know, things such as internships, research, tutoring, etc. What would be the best possible items? And I know, Kevin, you mentioned a few of these, but what else could they do beyond the norm? So for you, beyond student teaching, what could they do? And beyond taking and preparing for the exams, what type of experiences should they get while they're here at Bridgewater? Feel free to start, whoever's ready.
I'll start if you'd like. One thing I did here, I mentioned earlier on, is I worked in the math lab here at the university, or at the college at the time, and you know, it was a freshman skills program, and I don't know the capacity of that program these days or how it's run, but I worked there as a student tutor, and that gave me exposure to trying to communicate mathematical ideas to underachieving students. These students were people who were in a non-credit bearing course. So when Dr. Prendergast asked me if I was interested, because at the time I was a freshman, I thought, you know, I don't know enough math to help anybody, but she said, well, it's remedial math. So I tried it, and I ended up staying in the math lab for many years, and it emerged into sort of a drop-in center as well, where not just tutoring, you know, freshman skills, but we were tutoring calculus, or calculus 2 or 3 or whatever else. So by my experience working in that lab, I think it gave me a little more confidence when I went to do my student teaching that, hey, I actually can communicate my mathematical ideas to somebody. I've got practice doing that. So that was, I think, a bonus for me, and that would be something to maybe consider here on campus. Other things, I think, you know, maybe when I interview candidates with my principal, I tend to focus more on the mathematical side of things, but then my principal will say, well, what else are you bringing to our school system? Why else would we want to hire you? What makes you an outstanding candidate? And so other things that you do, because when you work in a high school, you might be asked to be a class advisor, or maybe they're going to need a basketball coach, or they're going to need a woman's swimming coach, or whatever else. So if you can expose yourself to those hobbies and whatever your interests are, and highlight those and showcase those in the interview process, that also could be something that sets you apart from another candidate.
Great. And there's a lot of opportunities, too, just to go off of the education piece again, on campus and beyond, just through the Community Service Center, you can become a tutor for something called Schools on Wheels, where you actually help tutor homeless children. You can become a tutor in the math lab, the Academic Achievement Center. I would imagine anything working in a sort of education focus, teaching, instruction, even coaching, lifeguarding, any of those extra pieces that you can add, again, to make yourself a well-rounded candidate would be great for that type of a role. Would you agree?
Absolutely.
Yeah, excellent.
Go next. So in addition, I've already gave my plea for internships. I do feel strongly, in case you didn't get that. and taking an exam or two is very helpful. Plus, it will be fresh in your mind. It's harder to take the first one or two exams when you've been away from it for a few years. So when you're taking the classes now, I think it's easier to take the first one or two exams. I also think a strong GPA, which sounds like, yeah, of course, that goes without saying, but I think in the actuarial profession, it holds a little bit more weight because you need to gauge, is this person able to pass the exams? I mean, that's really, to succeed in our, you're not forever taking exams, but in order to succeed, you can get your designation. You do have to pass the actuarial exams. And then the other thing I would say, to piggyback off of what Kevin was just saying, I do think that tutoring, working in the math lab, anything like that is really great, or even if it's not specific to math, that's fine, but I did both of those things when I was here, but you have to think, like, what an actuary is, it's someone who's really good at math that has to talk to non-math people in layman's terms and get across your point without scaring them away. That's really what it's all about. So if you've already demonstrated that you can explain complex ideas, math concepts, to people who might not be their strong point, I see that as a signal that this might be someone who then can talk to someone in claims or underwriting or sales and get our whole point across that we're trying to get across with regards to the numbers in a layman's terms takeaway.
Okay, well, like I said earlier, I don't have really a career lined up right now. I'm kind of just taking things as they go, and they're going pretty well, so, don't worry about that. Basically, what I'll say is, although you hear about internships and studying and everything like that, you do have to look at extracurricular activities. The math club is real nice and everything. The physics club is great. I guess what I'll be an advocate of is on-campus extracurricular groups, maybe some Greek life. I was part of Greek life here, my stay at Bridgewater State College, and throughout my time, I was known as the math guy. At the time, it was I wouldn't say it was a small area of the college, but everybody was either a teacher, an aviation science major, or an accountant. So it was always just hearing mathematics kind of startled people. They started asking me what I wanted to do with my life, and it was a little bit too personal, so, get away from my personal life, whatever. But basically what I did with that was, through my time in Greek life and my other organizations, I became the treasurer for two of my groups. Like I said, I did the Greek life here, and I also did off-campus group involvement as well. Although that didn't really do anything at the time, I'm sure that if I were to walk into some business that has financial dealings every day, and I were to have on my resume, well, I was the treasurer for 2 years, two and a half years, whatever it was, I'm sure that that would raise some eyebrows and question my experience in that field. So I although I won't limit it to Greek life, I will say that there is few organizations on campus that you can get involved in that will also help your career, or at least help build your resume so that you can help build your career later on.
Yeah, definitely. There are, I think, over 100 different student clubs and organizations here on campus. So there's really one that fits all of your unique interests. So whether that's Greek life, or if it is, an outdoor club or whatever it might be, all of those organizations need an executive board, including a treasurer. So you really could take on those skills and responsibilities within a leadership role, and that showcases very well on a resume and comes across nicely, again, as one of those kind of kickers within an interview situation or a job search situation. I also just want to mention, too, beyond sort of the clubs and organizations, Bridgewater also has a really unique program here called Streams, which is a way to basically improve the number of people graduating in the STEM areas. So within that, I believe that there are sort of peer-assisted learning programs and opportunities to connect with other students and faculty through research and whatnot. So certainly ask your professors about the STREAMS program and what opportunities there may be there to get involved. So again, academically and outside the classroom, there's just so much that you can do to really market yourself by the time you graduate. And then when you add on the internship experience and the specific requirements, like taking the exams or getting your license, you're going to have all of those pieces lined up for that type of a job. So that's great. That's really helpful. Next question I was wondering about is, what type of organizations or companies should students target for jobs in your industry? So should they be looking at government or private research or any of those areas? What would you recommend within your field?
I'll go.
Yeah.
Speaking as a recent grad, I will say that, not really so recent, but more recent than the others.
These old parts.
No offense.
We're young at heart, Chris.
What I will say is that it doesn't hurt to apply to any and all for some kind of experience. Like I said, I'm not really developing a career where I am right now this minute, but again, I could develop later on. But to start off, if you're not looking at anything specific, I would just say any and all. I mean, there's a reason that resume paper comes in packs of 300 and 500 and everything like that. Just print them out and just ship them out and see what happens. That's kind of what I did. And we'll see, we saw what happened there. I kind of got a job, landed it. And I'm starting to develop my career now. So if you really have no idea what to do, I would just say just get them out to anywhere.
For actuaries, I'd say probably the most common are insurance companies, like Liberty Mutual, GEICO, State Farm, Allstate, those types of companies, and consulting firms, so like Towers Watson, or what have you. But I feel like it's becoming more common to work outside of those traditional types of places of employment. So, certainly government, and even private corporations. I mean, you guys have probably all seen Moneyball. I was at a conference, an actuarial conference, a few months ago, and there was someone there who works for ESPN. And that's basically what he does. So there's, I think that really, the analytics are in high demand. So, and I think slowly people are understanding what actuaries bring to the table. So.
And Kevin, obviously for you, this is a traditional K-12 public school system, but even beyond that, any recommendations for other educational opportunities?
I would just say maybe do some research on the type of community that you might want to work in. I think in this day and age when a lot of educators post their information on something like SchoolSpring or one of those web-based places where a school can access a ton of resumes and candidates all at once, a lot of times what happens is we reach out to you. I've got an opening and I screen online all these candidates, and I might send you a letter and say, hey, would you be interested in interviewing for a job in my school system? But beyond that, do some research on your own and kind of get a feel for what communities are out there and say, geez, I really have a desire to work in an urban setting, or I really want to work in a suburban setting, and I think I might like this particular town. So go on the Department of Ed website and look at the school and community profile and get a sense of maybe what their MCAS scores are and, how many AP courses do they offer and what's the demographics of that community look like, and see if it's a match to what you might be looking for.
Yeah, and similar to that, I mentioned our CareerLink database, which is where you can search for internships and jobs. There's also another piece to that called our resume referral program. And basically what it is students can upload their resume to the system. And what happens is every now and then an employer might call us and say, we have this job opening, we're looking to fill it really quickly. Could you send us all math majors who are seniors or computer science majors? So we'll go on there, pull the resumes, and we ship it off to the employer. And so in essence, they could reach out to you without you having to do any work. And that's a great way to kind of, again, get your resume out there, because a lot of times in education, there are less people applying for math jobs than there would, say, an elementary English job. So they're searching for you in a lot of ways. So again, CareerLink would be a great place to do that, as well as something like SchoolSpring. And I also want to mention a really great resource that we use regularly with all students. It's called What Can I Do With This Major? And this is just a sample for math. So basically what it does is it explains what career options you have with a math degree. Obviously we're learning a lot about that today, but it dives a little bit deeper into specifics. So what it does is it explains the different areas or industries that you can pursue, and then in the middle it would tell you where you would work, like what type of company or organization would hire you in that industry. And then the far right will tell you tips and strategies for what you should be doing while you're in school now to prepare for that. So this resource right here is, you know, 4 or 5 pages long with so many different options in the math field. And this is available right on our website. It's called What Can I Do With This Major? So that's just an idea of something that can kind of give you a little bit more robust answer to that question we just discussed. Next, I'm curious about how does the job market currently look in your field? Obviously, the economy in the last 5 years or so has been poor, but how does the job market currently look in your field, and what would be the most important qualifications for entry-level candidates? I know you may have discussed these already. If you want to focus just on the market, that'd be fine too. Who would like to start?
Sure. I can start. So excellent for actuaries. They're consistently year in, year out rated the number one or number two job by the Jobs Rated Almanac. I know there was recently in the Wall Street Journal, actuaries were the number two job, second to, I think it was like software planner or something mm-hmm. like that. So even other sources, not just the Jobs Rated Almanac. There was also something recently in CNN Money saying that basically actuaries have 0% unemployment, and many students have job offers before they graduate, which I would say they probably had internships, but but I would definitely agree with that firsthand. I mean, even through the recession and everything, my phone is constantly ringing with recruiters trying to, you know, tell me about a job that they have. So, and I don't think there's many professions. I mean, if there was ever a testament to whether or not the career is, you know, secure, I think, you know, the last couple of years, it really speaks to that. If my phone is still ringing with recruiters, that's pretty impressive.
Mm-hmm. How's the job market in education looking?
I think it looks good for math. I've been at Silver Lake for 23 years and I've been the math coordinator for 10, and there hasn't been a year that I can recall in my 23 years there that we haven't had to hire at least one for either the middle or the high school. In most years it's been more than that. A couple years ago I hired 7, as I said, for the high school. So there are openings out there, and a lot of times I network with the other South Shore math coordinators and we'll call each other or send emails and say, hey, I've got a long-term maternity leave that I need to fill. You know anybody? So a lot of it's word of mouth between math department heads and coordinators. So I think the job market is pretty good for math majors, and one thing I think you have going for you as a recent grad, you often look more appealing than somebody who's been in the market for a long time. For example, if I left my school and went somewhere else, I'd have to hope that my reputation is out there and that somebody might take a chance, because my salary is up there compared to what you would be as a first-year teacher. And in this tough economic times, unfortunately, sometimes schools say, listen, Mr. Sawyer, when you do your hiring this year, we got to put a cap. This is the amount we're going to allow you to spend. So even if I really like this high-priced teacher, it doesn't often happen, but sometimes my school might say, you know what, really look for a cheaper candidate, because we've got to hire 7 teachers this year for the high school and we can't afford, you know, beyond a certain amount of money. So you're coming right out of college, you've got that kind of going for you. So I think the job market is still good for math majors and math teachers.
And 2 upcoming events to kind of test that would be 2 career fairs. One is right here on campus, so if you're thinking about a math teacher position, we do have our annual education career fair, and that's taking place on Wednesday, March 20th, right over across the street in the campus center. So Wednesday, March 20th from 4 to 7 p.m. And similarly, we have a panel as well as the actual career networking fair, where you can meet with upwards of 45 different school districts who are recruiting for possible teacher openings. So that's a great event. And then in April, there's also a career fair in Boston. It's called MERC, M-E-R-C, which is the Massachusetts Educational Recruiting Consortium. And that's taking place on Wednesday, April 17th from 9:30 to 3:30. It's going to be at Northeastern University this year, and there's usually upwards of 100 different school districts at that fair, and they're representative from all across New England and sometimes across the country, but the majority are from Massachusetts school districts. So yeah, there's a lot of great chances out there to network and to meet employers and to see what openings exist. And Chris, would you be able to talk a little bit about how MEDITECH is hiring? I know that they're kind of on a growth and what that market looks like for MEDITECH?
Yeah, the healthcare industry is a fairly sound industry, and you need software to switch over to the technology age. And I was going to get into the whole technology aspect of it. As technology gets better and improves, there's always need for somebody to either update or maintain the technology that we have. So the job market for that is very encouraging to see that there are so many open spots, and not even having a computer science degree, I just have a mathematics degree, that they picked me up. So I was very fortunate to know that they're not just looking for only computer science majors, but they are looking for people who are used to, I guess, analytical thinking and technology, computers and everything like that. So.
And before we open it up to the audience, do you have any final words of wisdom that you'd like to share for these students as they're starting off their career exploration and kind of planning that whole process? Anything that comes to mind?
Yeah, one word of wisdom that I have that I didn't say earlier is your transcript is really important. When I sort my resumes into those three piles I referred to as the good, bad, and the ugly, one thing that helps me sort them quickly is when I look at the grades that the undergraduate received. You know, I don't want somebody teaching the students in my district, if I look at their math courses and I see, wow, they got a whole lot of C's and D's and they really kind of floundered through a lot of their classes in school. So take your studies here very seriously, because that transcript really is as much of a part of you and your resume as anything else. So I think that's one big piece. And another one is, I did allude to earlier, do your homework on the local towns out there, because not all school systems are the same. You know, you might go to a certain town and say, well, geez, I hear they just built a brand new beautiful high school, so it's probably got great technology and everything that I'd want. But then you might look a little deeper and realize that the town is now somewhat in hock because they've overextended and now they're cutting teachers and the programs aren't what you thought they were going to be. So do your homework, because when you walk in as a first-year teacher, you want to know, how are you going to be supported in that school? Is there a person, like a middle management person, like a department head or a coordinator, who's going to work closely with you and be able to help you in those times of struggle and when you're doing your lesson planning or when you need immediate questions answered? Or is there no person in that role where maybe it's just the principal who's overseeing a school of 200 teachers or something? So do your homework on the schools and the towns that are out there, because they're not all the same.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I mean, a lot of the things I think I've already said, but, you know, just to reiterate, a strong GPA, get at least one, if you can get two exams passed while you're still an undergrad, it's a great thing. Get an internship. You know, definitely see if you can tutor or work in a math lab. I think that's a great thing. And I think just in general, like if you're thinking about, what can I do? I love math, but I don't necessarily want to teach. If you're looking for other avenues, you know, you want to work in the business world, but you still want to use your math skills, being an actuary is a great profession for that. And, you know, again, I definitely think you need to be the type of person who is considering graduate school. Like I said, you don't need to have a master's or a PhD to be an actuary, but you have to be that type of, be of that mindset that I am going to have to study after 5 o'clock, and there are going to be times, it's not year round, the exams are given twice a year, but there are going to be times on the weekend, you know, where your friends are going to the beach or what have you, and you're going to have to hit the, you know, books in the library, but it pays off. It's the job security, you know, the salary, it definitely is worth the extra time you put in earlier on in the career. And I will just add, a great resource if you want to research more about the career is www.beanactuary.org. All, you know, no spaces or beanactuary.org. So I encourage you to check out that website.
Thanks, Carol. And Chris?
And I would say, as kind of a word of wisdom, is more aside from the whole career aspect, it's know the difference between meeting somebody and networking. I would say that meeting somebody is introducing yourself to them, finding out who they are. But networking is really more trying to get them to remember you. Later on, you might have a set of skills where somebody will be like, oh, well, I need somebody who can open up a couple programs in software or something like that. I'm going to call Chris. So just kind of understanding the difference between just meeting people and actually networking. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that kind of reminds me of a special program that we do, which I know, Chris, I think you're in there as well, is Career Services has something called the Alumni Mentor Program, where you can actually search for Bridgewater alumni in various industries. I know we have a couple actuarial folks in there, certainly some teachers in there, and so on. And you can actually search for an alum in that field, and you can get a little profile about them, so where they work, what they do, when they graduated, and you can actually send them a message and start that networking process. That's a great tool because those people are in there for a reason. We have a set amount of people, so it's about 175 folks or so who have agreed to be a mentor. So they want to help you. They're waiting for you to contact them. So it's very different from just sending out a cold call or a cold email. So that's one great tool. But also going to things like this and meeting the panelists today after we finish up. Going on to LinkedIn, reaching out to professionals there. So there's so many different ways that you can network. And that's a process, again, that we'd be happy to speak with you more about if you were to come to Career Services for an appointment. So thank you for all of that. I'd love to open it up to the audience's questions. I'm sure there's a lot that's been on your mind as you've heard some of this insight. So why don't we just start by raising your hand. Feel free to stand and speak clearly for our panelists. Who has questions? And don't be shy.
Well, Carol, I think you've probably interested a lot of people in Actuary. How do they begin? When do you go for an internship after graduation?
I think that the best time is to do it the summer between their junior year and their senior year. And they'll start interviewing around December, January. Like, so I would say get your resumes mailed out by Christmas time. They'll start interviewing in January, February for placement in the following summer. So if you're a junior right now, you know, that doesn't mean you can't still try. But if you're a sophomore, I would say, you know, be thinking about, okay, next fall, I want to get all my ducks in order and I want to mail my resume out, my cover letter out by Christmas time. And then most of the interviews would happen during that time. But, you know, I also think that, you know, put aside your pride. I mean, it's still tough economic times, and that's what I was dealing with when I was graduating. And so, you know, I actually had a bachelor's, but I was in a graduate program at Boston College, and I just said, you know what, this is my way of getting my foot in the door. I'm probably overqualified, but I can get my foot in the door as an intern, and I knew the value in that, and, you know, it really paid off.
Is there some areas of undergraduate math work that they should concentrate on?
Like probability and statistics is definitely a huge one. I mean, literally, like something that we're working on right now is a filing, a homeowner's filing in New York, and you know we're dealing with hurricane modeling and stuff like that. We're literally, I'm like, okay, refresh my memory, gamma distribution, chi-square test, like that's literally part of our filing. So, you know, definitely probability and statistics is a huge one. But, you know, calculus is the fundamental, you know, there's definitely, that comes in. I don't use all of that on a daily basis, and I'm like, every day I'm walking around like gamma, gamma, gamma. I don't talk, you know, but it comes up, and you definitely need to be very comfortable with numbers, just analytical. But that's definitely a course, which I know is a core requirement anyway as a math major, but it would definitely be one that you want to excel at.
What other questions do we have?
Sorry. Yep. Carol, could you tell us how many of the actuarial exams are out there? They're not all mathematical.
Right, yes.
And what we might expect to see or to encounter in the first two.
Yeah, it's been a while since I've looked at the syllabus, but I don't think it's changed dramatically, but you're absolutely right. The first couple of exams are ones that, like I said, you're better off passing now when everything's fresh. You know, it's a lot of calculus, a lot of probability and statistics. And usually the first one or two exams, there's life actuaries and property casualty actuaries. All at the end of the day do similar things. They're just working with different types of risk. But in the beginning, they have a shared exam track, and then they get into specialties. But, you know, further on, you know, there's an accounting, there's lots of economics, there's definitely non, like I would have to, I think a lot of the stuff you take as a math major helps. It's been a long time, but I know I took an economics class and I know I took an accounting class when I was at Bridgewater. So if I don't know what the GREs are right now, our core, you know, requirements, but if you don't have to take one of those, but that is something that is an option, I would definitely take one of those because it certainly will help not only on your resume but future exams. Did that answer your question?
How many exams?
I believe it is 9 right now on the property casualty side. I'm not sure how many it is on the life side, but I also think there's like parts. Like I know when I was taking at them, you know, there'd be the fifth exam was made up of 5A and 5B, you know, and you could take them together, you could take them separately. Your first 7 exams is when you get your designation and you can officially call yourself an actuary, you're an associate. That's what allows you to sign like loss reserve opinions and things like that and really be an official actuary. As a fellow, I think it's definitely worthwhile to, it's just 2 more exams, but like if you wanted to be the chief actuary of a company, you're probably gonna need your fellowship. But if you, like, I definitely, there's all different types of actuaries. I categorize myself as I like all the analytics, but I really like the business side. You know, I always say like, oh, what do I want to be when I grow up? it's going to always involve analytics, but I like the business side more. I don't see myself, like I have no desire to be the number one actuary at Liberty Mutual, the chief actuary. I'd rather now, you know, like I said, I was an assistant controller. I've worked and headed up their regional operations. I like the business side, but I think you want to, at the very least, get to that designation of an associateship, which is the first 7 exams, I believe. And I definitely saw doors start opening left and right and recruiters calling me once I got that designation.
You in the back.
I have a couple of specific questions for the actuary. Can you list off some specific courses that I could take now to better prepare myself for the financial math exam?
For the financial math exam?
Yeah, exam 2.
Okay. Like I said, like I'd have to, the syllabus may have changed since I was taking those exams.
But
I mean, certainly, I'm guessing there's got to be economics on there. So I would definitely, if you haven't taken like micro or macroeconomics, you want to do something like that. I don't think there's much accounting until you get further on, but I do recall when I was taking them, economics was in the earlier, you know, definitely within the first 5 exams, there was heavy concentration on economics. So that would, to complement the courses you're already taking as a math major, I would definitely look to see if you can find an economics class that would be helpful.
I also wanted to ask, which of the preliminary exams most heavily involve econometrics?
I'm not sure. I mean, like I said, it's been a few years since I've taken the exams and the syllabus has changed, so I couldn't speak to, I could say, well, when I took exam 1 back in the day, when I took exam 3, but I know the syllabus has changed over the years. You know, what I had as exam 6 is now exam 7. You know, so I would be worried to advise you because they'd be like, okay, that was like 15 years ago. but if you go to, go to the website of beanactuary.org, you could go to the CAS website, which is www.cas.org, which is the casualty actuarial track, and they will define everything that's on the syllabus for every exam, and the SOA, Society of Actuaries, is the life track. So you could go to their website as well, and they will give you specifics. And I believe they'll also give you guidance of classes you might want to take, courses that you might want to take.
All right, thank you very much.
Yep.
I have a question over here.
Mr. Sawyer, you mentioned that you were in math services when you went to college here. My question would be, how is the transition from working one-on-one with a student to actually working with a larger group of students?
I started in the math lab here in the Freshman Skills Center I think it was my second semester. So as a freshman, I started in it myself. And I worked in it all the way through till I graduated. So I had a lot of experience working with not just individual students, but small groups. Back then, you might have worked with a group of anywhere from 5 to 7 students at one time. And they weren't all necessarily working on the same things. So you might be helping a couple of kids with decimals and fractions. Somebody else might be working on probability or something else. So I think my confidence grew. You know, certainly as a freshman, I was very leery about even stepping foot in that center because I felt like I was much more of an English person. And until I got my confidence and said, you know what, I really do know a lot more math than I thought I did, and am able to communicate it, after working there for 4 years, I think it was the best thing I could have done to make me feel confident when I did my practicum, walking back into a classroom and working, you know, taking over a class. I actually had experience in the math lab redoing a lot of the things that they did there were sort of worksheet driven. And so I sort of, over the years that I worked there, had a chance to revise some of the materials even. So it gave me a chance to work with curriculum ideas and assessment and all that. So it was a great experience and prepared me well.
More towards Chris, but I don't know if you might really answer. I'm a math major, but I've been taking a lot of courses in other areas, and you're at MEDITECH, so that must have to do like with some bio and stuff like that. Do you feel like you should have taken more courses in biology or other sciences, or computer science, like that you would recommend that other students take now, like while we're still in college or something like that?
I would say the one thing that I wish I took was more, believe it or not, more general education courses, like just kind of like about the world. Like I took like Canadian studies, and that's actually, believe it or not, that's helped me a lot because we have an 80% sharehold over all of the hospitals and health centers in Canada. So I actually learned a lot about some of my sites from actually taking that course. So it's like I said, it's more general education, more about the learning, more about maybe something you didn't think that you'd want to know. If you have spare credits that you need to take care of, you need to address, then I would pick something that's out of your comfort zone. Maybe just so that one day you can bring it up somehow, or you would never think in 1,000 years that you would need Canadian studies, but I use it almost every day.
I would actually add to that language would be some courses to take, say Spanish or whatnot. I know specifically with MEDITECH, they actually have positions that are heavily focused on being able to speak Spanish fluently. So you'd be doing the same job, but being able to translate that, especially within a hospital or healthcare setting, because a lot of times the patients are very multicultural and diverse. So having that extra language skill would be great. So if you would ever consider that, I think the same would probably apply to the education field. If you have that language ability, being able to teach students of other languages would come into play. And again, it would just be that kind of value-added bonus to your degree in math and your solid analytical skills. So I would also recommend the language, too.
I would think communication classes, too. I mean, I know, I don't know what your core requirements are now, but I know that I took one, and I think no matter what you end up doing, a communications class is really helpful. I would advise you, I have a funny story. When I think I was a junior, and like the word on the street was that the sexual education, or like whatever it was, like human sexuality class was an easy A. So I was like, all right, good, I'll just do that. That will satisfy one. And literally, I know it's like, I laugh now because I'm like, oh my God, he could have been fired for like us laughing about this in my interview at Liberty Mutual, but he's like, you got an A in human sexuality. I'm like, it came across like I studied so hard and I know so much about the subject. So think wisely before you take those requirements. But I do think, like, in general, don't be afraid, like, to shake it up a little bit, and you know, it makes you jump off the page, it separates you. I think having even, like, not that you want to, obviously you want to walk into an interview doing your homework, studying the company or the school district or whatever, and take it seriously, dress appropriately, etc., but you know, you want to be human too. I mean, when I think back, like, I mean, I was like laughing in my interview with the people interviewing me, like they wanted someone human. And I know that after I got hired, I had to take someone, a candidate, to lunch, and I, you know, we were in the cafeteria, and I had asked her like a question, and I had this flatbread pizza with chunks of grilled vegetables, and I was like, it wouldn't cut, and like I slipped, and literally a big chunk of zucchini went over and landed on her tray, and she never like missed a beat and just like kept answering me, and I was like, and she never acknowledged the zucchini, and I was like, this is awkward, like I can't get past the zucchini. And and so after, when we were all like, you know, talking about like, what did you think, and I told my boss, I was like, I told him the story, and he's like, see, no sense of humor. And he's like, and I was like, really? And he's like, no, seriously. You know, not that like, you know, you have to go in there like a duck walked into a bar, but he's like, you're going to be with these people a long time. You know, you're there, you know, and especially as actuaries, I mean, like they, you know, sweats, scrunchies, like, you know, you're in there, you're like studying, and you know, you want someone who's human and, right, you know, who will pick the zucchini off and throw it back.
Yeah, you definitely need a good balance.
Yeah.
And we could actually do practice interviews with students if you're preparing.
Yeah, I'll throw food at you. We'll see how you react.
Just throw stuff at you, tomatoes, whatever it takes to get you to show your personality. I think we have time for about one more question, because I want to make sure that you all get fed the nice food and drink that will hopefully be outside and have time to network with our panelists. So one more question. Anything? Oh, far back there.
I have a question for Chris. Mm-hmm. I was wondering how you got into computer science field coming from math and science, and what courses that you took during your studies that you find most helpful in your line of work.
Yeah, I actually, the combination of the math degree as well as the customer service was really what sold them, well, sold myself to them. But there was one class, computer algebra, where you have to, I don't know if you do it now, but I know when I was here, the computer algebra course was basically you have to create a program that gets this little robot around these walls and picks up these little bags of sand or whatever the heck they are. But yeah, that was what was highlighted when they were asking me questions. Oh, have you ever developed software code before? And I had to say yes, of course, because of that class. But yeah, that was as you can tell, well, not can tell, but if you've ever met a legitimate computer programmer, they are very analytical, but they are also kind of, they put the blinders on, they sit behind the computer, so they like the combination of the mathematics background with the computer science background, as well as the customer experience, customer service experience.
I think today too, like I know a lot of our actuarial analysts use SAS and, you know, different, so I think that that's a great thing to have anyway. Like even if you're like, okay, I want to be an actuary, but I definitely don't want to be a programmer, it still looks good because you're, especially SAS, like you should definitely take a SAS course if they offer it here.
Well, unfortunately we need to end our panel discussion portion, but I'd really like to thank our panelists, Carol, Chris, and Kevin, for participating. We really appreciate your insight and your willingness to share your perspective on the various career fields. Please let's give our panelists a round of applause.